Hi, welcome back to Indigo Smokes Tarot and Astrology. I'm going to be changing my name, my YouTube name, in a minute because I have some good news, but I'll save that for another video. This is just going to be a kind of an Ask Indigo video. I had someone DM me and they asked me a few really good questions, and I decided that I would just also answer them via video, even though I already responded to that person. I'm not going to mention their name, but I figured he asked some really good questions, and other people may either have those questions or they will have those questions, you know, at some point in the future. So I just wanted to put, you know, those same questions out here, answer them for anyone who may, you know, be inquiring about the same thing. I may do more Ask Indigo videos. It just depends on if a lot of people DM me and ask me certain things. But anyways, the person who DM'd me, they asked me, how do I connect with my higher self and my ancestors? And I do have a notebook here just to keep me on track with the questions that were asked. So yeah, that's pretty much what this particular video is going to be about. This isn't a tarot reading or astrology. So I'm just going to light some incense here just for ambiance for myself. But it was a really good question that he asked me. I was like, huh. And I had to really think about it because honestly, I just do things on an intuitive level. I don't really put thought into, okay, how do I want to connect with my higher self? How do I want to connect with my ancestors? I kind of just go with the flow. But when he asked me that, it really made me think, and I'm like, huh, I guess I really do have certain techniques that I do. So first off, before I say anything, always use your own discernment and do what feels right for you. As far as connecting with your higher self and connecting with your ancestors, the sky is the limit. You know, everyone isn't going to connect with their higher self or their ancestors in the same exact way, and that's fine. First and foremost, go do what works for you, do what feels right for you, and use your own discernment, okay? What I'm saying here is just what I've done in the past and what works for me and what I resonate with, okay? So, anyways, I'm going to start with the higher self part. So, I have different ways of connecting with my higher self. I've never been the traditional meditation person. Especially not in the beginning of my spiritual journey. I can do more of it now, but it's still not my go-to. I'm a Gemini rising, so I have a lot of restless energy, and I actually find that I meditate a lot better when I'm doing an activity that I can fully immerse myself in. So, for example, I'm a music head. I love to listen to music no matter what I'm doing. And so sometimes I'll meditate just by paying attention to the instruments that are playing in the background of the song, like just, you know, picking up on the nuances. Like, it gives you something to focus your conscious mind on. Another thing that I do is I connect with my higher self through, you know, tarot cards and oracle cards. You know, sometimes, you know, we all, you know, just as, you know, spiritual beings having a human experience, we're all going to have those moments where we're foggy sometimes. And for those times, or those times when I'm wanting like a specific quick answer, or, you know, I'm trying to pinpoint exactly what I'm feeling, I'll use tarot. I'll ask it a specific question to just gain insight into where my energy is, where I am psychologically, and, you know, I'll ask my higher self a certain question, and then I'll pull a card, you know. So that's one way that I connect with my higher self. On and off, I don't do this as consistently as I used to, and I need to get back to it. I also used to light candles as an offering to my higher self, you know, just as a form of, like, I would light the candle. You don't have to, but I'm a candle person. I like the elements of fire and water, so I do a lot of candle work, and I do a lot of work, a spiritual work with water. So I would light a candle, and I would just start to talk to my higher self. Sometimes I'll just write. You know, I have an overactive mind, and sometimes in order for me to really be able to tune into what my higher self is saying or what my ancestors are saying, I kind of have to do a brain dump. And so I'll just write down all the things that, because, you know, for example, how you'll try and sit there and you'll try to meditate, and then your mind, it's called monkey mind, it'll just start throwing things at you, things that, you know, you haven't thought about in days or weeks or years, and it's like, where the hell did that come from? You'll just start thinking of everything, your fears, your to-do list, the past, things that are so old you don't even remember how they popped up into your brain. Like, those are the things that will resurface as you are trying to meditate in the traditional way. And so whenever I'm going to meditate in the traditional way, I'll kind of do a brain dump where I just write down all of the things that are running through my brain, so that when I'm sitting there meditating, I don't feel the need to pay attention to all of those thoughts, and it's a lot easier to just let those thoughts pass. So that's one way. So I'm trying to keep track. So through tarot, connect my higher self, through just writing, like brain dumping before I meditate. Sometimes I light a candle, and just focus on the flame. Also, what else do I do? I'm trying to be specific about what I do in regards to my higher self and like meditating in that aspect. Music, I feel like that's it. As far as my ancestors and my guides and communicating with them, it's some of the same techniques, to be honest. So all of my divination tools, my pendulum, my tarot cards, my oracle decks, those are all dedicated to my higher self and my ancestors, because those are the only people that, or those are the only energies that I want to communicate with, because I know that I can trust it. I know that I can trust them, and I know that, you know, just with all of the spiritual work that I do and me cleansing and blessing my decks, I know that when I dedicate those to my higher self and my ancestors, that that is who is communicating back with me when I am doing readings for myself, and so on and so forth. So I do use divination as a form of communication between my higher self and my ancestors, but more so my ancestors. Pendulums are really good for yes or no questions when you just need a quick answer, quick insight. Tarot for me is more of an intuitive meditation tool. I'm going to do another video on that, but like I said, all of my divination tools are dedicated to my ancestors, so I do sometimes ask them questions, like after I refresh their altar and give them offerings, I'll, you know, ask them certain things, and then I'll pull a card, you know. What else? My dreams, synchronicities. So I feel like I say in most of my tarot readings, to pay attention to your confirmations, your synchronicities, and your dreams, because that is honestly how your ancestors and your guides, and sometimes even your higher self, that's how they communicate with you. A lot of people expect that they're gonna hear like a voice when they're communicating with their guides or their ancestors, and some people do and some people don't. Some people grow into that and some people never do. For me personally, sometimes I do hear like a certain voice in response to a question that I'm asking, but normally it's when I'm not expecting it. You know, I can't, it's not something that I've fine-tuned to the point where I ask something and then I immediately hear an answer. That's not really how it works. And when I say hear a voice internally, I don't mean that I hear someone else's voice in my head. I mean that I hear my voice, but it's something that I wouldn't say, or it doesn't sound like something that I would come up with. So that's how I know when it's coming from an ancestor or my higher self, because even though I hear it internally in my own voice, it's not something that I would normally say, you know. And I actually find that my ancestors in particular, they're very sarcastic, like they have a sense of humor, and a lot of the times they'll say something funny when I'm not in the mood to be laughing, you know. So I don't want to lose my train of thought, but when you are trying to connect with your ancestors, and when you set up your ancestor altar and so on and so forth, whenever you inquire and you ask them something, from that point forward, you need to pay attention to your surroundings, your environment, even on the most mundane level, you know. Those are called confirmations and synchronicity. So for example, I can, or you, let me put an example of you. So you can easily ask your ancestors for guidance on a particular subject, whether or not you should take a particular job, whether or not you can trust a certain person, and then lo and behold, maybe an hour, 2 hours later, at some point later on in your day, you may randomly hear a song in a car that's passing by you, and it's like, huh, did that just answer my question? So it's kind of like that. Like, you have to pay attention to the cues in your environment to kind of, you know, build up a language, so to speak, of how they communicate with you.
Hold on.
Okay. So, yeah, so pay attention to your environment. And then your dreams. Honestly, the dream world, the astral realm, is where your ancestors and your higher self especially come through, and they talk to you through symbols, because that is when you are most receptive and you're not distracted by, you know, the outside world or the matrix, whichever you want to call it. So dreams, okay, even if you can't remember every single thing about your dreams, you want to write down the most obvious or symbolic thing about the dream. So even if it's just one thing, because I know that a lot of the times it can be very hard to remember all of your dreams, because a lot of times you have more than one dream within a dream. And then sometimes, you know, upon awakening, it's immediately blurry. So I do recommend keeping a journal by your bed. That way, as soon as you get up, you can write down whatever you remember. Okay, even if you don't remember it all, you will remember the parts that are necessary for you to remember. Okay. As of lately, just for example, I haven't particularly asked any questions to my higher self or my ancestors, but my dreams have been super, super vivid lately. They've always been vivid, but they're kind of like at an all-time high right now. And I just, there's always something that really stands out in my dreams that I remember upon awakening, and I immediately write it down, you know, think about it for a minute and try and come to a conclusion on what I think it means. And then I'll go to, you know, my dream book, or I'll go to Google and be like, what does such and such mean? So, for example, a couple of nights ago, maybe last week, I had a dream about rats. I'm not a rat person. I think rats are creepy. I don't want anything to do with them in the real world. So I had to really think about, what do rats mean to me? And other than annoying and pissed, I couldn't really think of anything. So I did go to Google, and the first definition that I seen was the Chinese symbology of, you know, I believe it was like good fortune, prosperity, or something like that. And I remember it being like three rats in my dream, and they were like gray, and I was just like, what the fuck, what is this? So that was one dream that I had, and I wrote down what that meant, but I don't really remember what it said. But I think rats have to do with like good fortune and prosperity, and things are really doing well for me as far as, you know, my business and things like that. So I take that as a good thing. Other than that, the only thing that I thought of with the rats was just that maybe like just to be careful of certain people that may show up in my environment. So that's kind of what I got from that. And then also another dream that I had was, I had a dream there was a crazy man. I've had a dream that I was in a car with a crazy man who had a Sith. I think that's how you say that. You know, like what the Grim Reaper has, or Santa Muerte, that hook thing. And it's pretty obvious what that means, because that's on the tarot cards typically. So, you know, that's associated with death, but dreams are symbolic. They're very rarely literal. Even though I have had dreams that have come to pass and they turned out to be premonitions or, you know, things like that, most of my dreams are more so symbolic than literal. But obviously the Sith, it correlates with change, cutting things off, death, but it also means harvest, you know. And I feel like all of those apply to me right now. Like I'm going through a very intense change and transformation, and I'm cutting a lot of things out. So there's that. Let me see. Right the night after that, I had a dream that I was in a car again. And this time I had a newborn baby. Well, not a newborn, but maybe like 8 months. The baby could have been no more than like 8 months old. And I can't remember the face of the baby, whether I knew it or not. But I think when I was in the dream, I thought it was my little sister when she was a baby. But I'm not really sure. But babies mean creation, birthing something new, you know, entering into a new phase, maybe, you know, feeling like a child all over again because you are in a new cycle of life and you have to relearn yourself and relearn your environment. So, you know, it's very symbolic, you know, and what a symbol means to me in my subconscious isn't necessarily what it's going to mean to you in your subconscious. So that's why you really have to get in tune with what it is that, you know, symbols mean to you. That way, when they pop up in your dreams, or even when they pop up just in your waking life, you have an idea of what they mean, you know. So those are just examples, but ancestors, they typically communicate through confirmation, synchronicity sometimes, and more often than not in your dreams. And then sometimes, you know, for me personally, when I'm getting off track, or when I'm not paying attention, when I'm falling off of my spiritual work, I always get, you know, some person who has a spiritual gift, and they come up to me and they tell me some shit that no one else could have known, you know. So those are just like different ways that your ancestors can come through and talk to you and guide you and different things like that. And for those who have their own spiritual gifts they're trying to cultivate, you really should one, tune in with yourself, do your research, and see which like the clairs, they're called like clairvoyance, claircognizance, clairsentience, and all of those things. See which one really resonates with you, and slowly, we all have them. We all have all of those abilities within us, but some of them are more stronger than the others, and some are more dormant, you know, require more work. And then if you don't want to develop all of them, you don't have to. You know, you can just develop the ones that you feel you naturally have the strongest. But for me, I have a lot of claircognizant, a lot of clairvoyant, and sometimes clairsentient moments. So clairsentience is feeling, you know, you get a certain feeling. But strongly for me is claircognizance and clairvoyance. Like, sometimes I'll just get flashes of things. And to me, I usually associate that with, like, deja vu. Like, I'll go through, like, I'll have a clairvoyant moment and forget about it. And then days later or weeks later, I'll experience something or I'll see something. And it's, like, a weird sense of deja vu. So clairvoyance is really strong for me. Claircognizance, I feel like that happens more than all of them. Claircognizance is just when you just know. You know, it's kind of like just when you get that epiphany and it's like, okay, that's what I need to do. I get that a lot. To me, that's another way that your guides, your ancestors, your higher self will communicate with you. You'll just have a moment where something just clicks, you know, and I take that as you are basically just getting a download from your higher self or from your ancestors, and it's just like, okay, I get it now, you just know, okay? So those are the different ways of, you know, communicating with your ancestors and how they can come through your environment. Like I said, it's not gonna show up the exact same way for everybody, so you really just have to connect with yourself and see what resonates with you and what works for you. Let me see what else. Another way of connecting, I honestly think and feel, because this is my experience, that traditional meditation is fine, but that's not going to work for everybody, and not everybody is physically capable of doing that. So honestly, I just say find an activity that you can lose yourself in, where you lose sense of time, where you lose sense of reality, and you are fully in the moment, in the present moment, concentrated and immersed in what it is that you're doing in that moment. Okay, there's a saying in Zen Buddhism. What do you do before enlightenment? Chop wood, carry water. What do you do after enlightenment? Chop wood, carry water. And what that means is that there can be a sense of ritual or meditation in the mundane. Or at least that's what I take from it. Sorry, this light is dimming. Okay, I'm gonna have to charge that. But anyways, you can easily turn a mundane thing into a form of meditation. If you are washing the dishes, completely focus on washing the dishes. If you're listening to a song, completely focus on listening to that song. Pick up on the nuances and the instruments and the sounds that maybe you never paid attention to before. Try and isolate, okay, I hear this instrument. Okay, I hear this instrument. Okay, that can really help you to, like, fine-tune your clairaudience, you know, paying attention to the sounds that you hear. Let me see what else. But literally anything that you do, if you are a creative person, if you're an artist, if you're a dancer, if you're a singer, fully immerse yourself in that and do it with a spiritual intention of turning it into meditation, and you'll be surprised, you know, as you do it. Maybe not the first time, but over time you may experience where you just get, like I said, clear cognitive moments where you just know something, or you get a sudden download, or, you know, you get a flash of something that can happen in your future, you know, different things like that. So yeah, I think I covered pretty much everything from music, confirmation, synchronicities, dreams, tarot, divination tools are really good for connecting with all aspects of yourself and your guides, your ancestors. If you're someone who works with deities, you can still, you know, you can dedicate some of your tools to a particular deity, and you know, when you want to communicate with them, you know, you can do it that way. But I'm ancestors and my higher self is a strong center focal point of my spiritual work, but that's just me. Do what works for you. And I believe that is it for how you can connect with your higher self and your ancestors, and those are the ways that I in my past experience have connected with them. And let me see, I think that's it. Sometimes, like I said, I'm a fire person, a water person, so I will focus on the fire of a candle or the fire in a fireplace, and I can really just get stuck in a trance with that, and you can have a lot of downloads or clairvoyant moments with that as well. And for example, I don't do a lot of indoor water scrying as of yet, but I'm going to start because I just really like water. But for example, I love to go to the beach, and when I go to the beach, I just stare at the water, and I get a lot of clarity from that. I get a lot of downloads from that. It inspires a lot of my poetry, you know. So if you're someone who connects with the elements, you can use those particular elements as a focal point for you meditating and clearing your mind so that you can hear, you know, the guidance of your higher self and or your ancestors. Okay, so I hope that this has been helpful. I hope this wasn't too long for you, and I hope that it all made sense and it's coherent. Honestly, take what resonates for you, you know, experiment, see what you like, and go from there. But alright, I'm gonna close this video out, charge this light so I can record another video for the next question, and thank you. Mwah.